Good afternoon. I would like to welcome everyone joining us today for today's Foreign Press Center briefing. We're very pleased to have with us today State Department spokesman Ned Price for an update on U.S. foreign policy. He will make some opening remarks, and after that, we'll be glad to take your questions. Just a reminder, when we go to question and answer, please wait for the microphone and raise your hand. Ned, thank you so much for joining us today. I'll turn it over to you.
Doris, thank you very much. Thank you very much to the FPC for the invitation to be here today. There's no better way to start off the year than with a briefing here at the FPC. And of course, most importantly, many thanks to all of you. I mean that in the literal sense, many thanks to all of you for being here. Glad to see we have such a full room. But more importantly, thanks for what it is that you do every single day. Just as the work of our domestic press is so vitally important to the health of our own democracy, your work is indispensable to countries and peoples around the world. I know that many of you, probably all of you, have colleagues around the world whose jobs entail significant risks. And all of you have colleagues who have been harassed, detained, or potentially even worse. And in some cases, some of you in this room have been victim to that as well. In many cases, that's because repressive governments and other bad actors around the world recognize just how important, just how equalizing, just how empowering your work is. It's why we constantly stand up for press freedom around the world, and it's why I especially relish the opportunity to start the year speaking to all of you this morning. So without further ado, why don't we turn to questions? I understand Carolina Chamoy from DW. Do you want to start?
Thank you. Thanks, Ned. Well, it's regarding Biden's visit to Mexico. I mean, we know that the U.S. administration is always very clear about democracies, defending democracies in the world, and you just said it, also press freedom. However, I just came back from the press briefing in the White House, and they said that on the agenda, immigration is going to be the main topic, climate, economic relations. So what happens with democracy? I mean, I'm sure you know that there are some policies going on in Mexico undermining democracy there. Is that not going to be an issue?
Thanks very much for the question. So as you heard from the White House, the president is looking forward to traveling to Mexico City Monday and Tuesday. He'll have an opportunity while there to engage bilaterally with our Mexican partners, with our Canadian partners, and then trilaterally in the context of the North American Leaders Summit on Tuesday. And the North American Leaders Summit is really about fostering a more competitive North American economy in an era of strategic competition. That is our top priority. Our hemispheric partners, we of course have no more important partners than Canada and Mexico. We share a broad bilateral agenda, a broad trilateral agenda when it comes to the North American Leaders Summit platform. And this opportunity will be one where the president can focus on advancing our strategic objectives for North America. We look forward to discussing all of the elements of that broad agenda, mitigating climate change, enhancing citizen security, strengthening North American competitiveness, improving public health, bolstering economic integration, supporting humane migration within the hemisphere, and advancing diversity, equity, and inclusion. Embedded within all of this are the values that we share with partners around the world, and of course that includes with our Canadian and Mexican partners. So citizen security, democracy, human rights, these are always on the agenda everywhere we go, and the broad agenda that the president will have when he speaks to his counterparts in the context of the North American Leaders Summit will be reflective of the broad set of shared values and shared interests we have with our Canadian and Mexican partners. Let's go to Omar Achi of Maghreb Arabe.
Thank you, Ned. I have a question regarding the Middle East, especially the Negev Forum Summit. Sorry. There is a steering committee meeting next week, if you can confirm that. And preparing for the next ministerial summit, if you can just speak up or give any details on this, and what role can you see for Morocco playing in bringing people's opportunities and development to the region and broadly to the peace process in the Middle East. Thank you.
Thanks very much for the question. I'm not in a position today to confirm any future convenings, but I would expect that we'll have additional details to share before too long. As you know, in the meeting in July of the NEGA Forum, the participants established the working groups focused on six key areas: regional security, clean energy, food and water security, health, tourism, and education. Tourism, education, and coexistence. And so these working groups seek to advance coordinated initiatives between the members of the founding members of the Negev Forum to encourage what this is all about: regional integration, cooperation, development for the benefit of the people of the region, including, of course, initiatives that could strengthen the Palestinian economy and improve the quality of lives for the Palestinian people. This is about the Negev Forum process, is about building bridges and building opportunity for the members, for those who have decided to normalize relations with Israel, between Israel and its neighbors. But we've consistently said this process and normalization itself is not a substitute for progress when it comes to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And of course, we continue to be very focused on that as well. When it comes to Morocco's role, of course, Morocco has been a leader when it comes to normalization. Morocco-Israel ties create and have created real benefits for the peoples of both countries, new opportunities for peace and prosperity and economic opportunity to flourish in Morocco and in Israel as well. Morocco has a unique relationship with the Palestinians, of course. King Mohammed VI is the chairman of the Al-Quds Committee of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. And we appreciate Morocco's role in providing aid and assistance to the Palestinian people and to supporting a two-state solution, something that, of course, is at the center of all of our efforts in the region as well. We'll continue to engage with Israel, with other countries in the region, and even beyond, frankly, to attempt to broaden this circle of opportunity, this circle of normalization, and we'll look for other opportunities to enhance cooperation between these countries and between Israel and its neighbors. Let's go to Bochin Han of the China Morning Post.
Hi, thank you. I wanted to ask about preparations for Blinken's trip to Beijing. Are there any holdups to confirming the trip that we should be aware of?
There are not any holdups. This is, like all of our trips, a process. This was a trip that was agreed to between the two presidents when they met in Bali. It was agreed that the next step would be for the Secretary of State to travel to the PRC early this year. We are just now in this year, 2023. I do expect that we'll have more details to share about this upcoming travel in the coming weeks. But this will be an extension of the efforts between the two presidents to responsibly manage the relationship. And in every single one of our engagements with the PRC, whether that's been at the senior-most levels, the calls and the video teleconferences, and most recently the face-to-face meeting between President Xi and President Biden, whether it's been between in the context of our previous meetings with Wang Yi, the outgoing foreign minister, or with Yang Jiechi, this has always been core to what we seek to do, to manage the relationship responsibly, recognizing that it's a relationship that is predicated at on competition, but also understanding that it's a relationship that is multifaceted and that it has elements that are and potentially can be collaborative. The world we know expects us to work together collaboratively where we can and where we must on shared challenges like climate, like global health, other transnational threats, while also managing the elements of the relationship that are more adversarial. And it is our goal, it's our responsibility to see to it that we have a relationship with the PRC where we can maintain open lines of communication, establish a floor to the relationship, and see to it that competition, which we welcome, which we think is a good thing, does not veer into conflict. That's ultimately our goal. So the Secretary will have an opportunity to discuss this in much further detail with his PRC interlocutors, I would expect, in the coming weeks, and we'll have more details on this trip just as soon as we are in a position to announce it. We'll go to Mia Tanaka of Kyoto News.
Thank you for taking my question. I have a question on Japan's new national security policy. China has expressed its firm opposition to Japan's security policy, which includes a significant increase in defense spending and the acquisition of so-called counter-strike capabilities. Are there any concerns that China could use Japan's moves to justify its assertive behavior in the region and its military buildup? And do you think Japan should communicate well with China about its intentions regarding its new security policy? And quickly on Ukraine, Ukraine President Zelensky is inviting Japanese Prime Minister to visit Ukraine, and Japan being the host of G7, and given that Ukraine's support will likely be a key agenda item during the G7 summit, would you encourage Prime Minister Kishida to travel to Ukraine to see the actual situation by himself? Thank you.
On your second question first, travel decisions are going to be a decision that each individual country will have to make. What is most important to us is that countries around the world continue to stand up for and to stand with the government of Ukraine, the people of Ukraine, and to stand against this brutal war of aggression that Moscow is waging on an unjustified, illegal, unprovoked basis against the country and people of Ukraine. Japan, for its part, has been a stalwart member, stalwart supporter of Ukraine. It has, through the G7 process, been with us even before February 24th. We worked very closely with our Japanese allies in an effort to make clear to Moscow that if it did indeed go forward with its plans for this brutal aggression against Ukraine, it would be subject to extraordinarily biting sanctions, to export controls, to other financial measures. That's on the punitive side, that's on the response side, but Japan has also been a stalwart friend to Ukraine, providing much needed assistance to the government, to the people of Ukraine, and certainly we expect that will continue as well. When it comes to Japan's new security strategy, the documents that it has released in recent weeks, as you know, we have heartily welcomed those. The President, the Secretary, the National Security Advisor have all welcomed those explicitly. The President laid out in our own national security strategy the fact that our alliances, our partnerships, are our most important strategic asset. And that is a fundamental recognition within Japan's new national security strategy, the recognition that these partnerships and alliances reshape the ability of our alliance with our Japanese allies to promote peace and to protect the rules-based order in the Indo-Pacific and around the world. We applaud Japan's commitment to modernize our alliance through increased investment and enhanced roles, missions, capabilities, and closer defense cooperation with the United States and other allies and partners in the Indo-Pacific and beyond. That's spelled out very clearly in these new documents. And we look forward to having an opportunity next week when the foreign minister is here, the defense minister is here, the prime minister is here, first in the consultative so-called 2+2 meeting next week between Secretary Austin, Secretary Blinken, and their Japanese counterparts, and then, of course, the summit meeting between President Biden and the prime minister that will take place at the White House on Friday. So we very much welcome this. We look forward to the opportunity. And the only other point I would make is that what you've heard from our Japanese allies is an effort to advance a vision of a free and open Indo-Pacific. That is the vision we share with our Japanese allies. It is a vision that we share with our allies and partners throughout the Indo-Pacific. A free and open Indo-Pacific, of course, is not a threat to anyone. What Japan has announced in its new national security doctrine should not be perceived as a threat to anyone. This is just an effort on the part of our Japanese allies to position themselves to most effectively advance that vision for a free and open Indo-Pacific and to be positioned to be positioned vis-a-vis those who have an alternative vision to our own vision. With that, why don't we go to Saruba Shukla of News Mobile?
Yeah, hi, Ned. Good to see you. Hi, Ned. Good to see you and Happy New Year. India and the U.S. are strategic allies, and India currently holds the chair of G20. Prime Minister Modi recently had a conversation with President Zelensky and also Russian President Putin. How would you react if India were to mediate between Russia and Ukraine and bring an end to this war, because that's what the world needs? You know, India and U.S. being close partners, how would you react to this? Are you aware of any back channels happening currently as we speak?
Thanks very much for the question. On this, we are engaging very closely with all of our allies and partners around the world on the question of Russia's brutal aggression against Ukraine. Of course, that includes India. The international community firmly recognizes the need to hold Russia to account for the atrocities that it's committed and that its forces are committing in Ukraine. Russia's war has affected not only Ukraine. As important as Ukraine is and this conflict, this war that Russia is perpetrating against Ukraine is, this is much bigger in a sense. It has affected countries around the world in any number of ways. Foreign Minister Jaishankar stated during his November visit to Moscow that this war, in the aftermath of 2 years of the COVID pandemic, has caused significant economic pain, particularly to developing countries. We've also have seen a spike in food prices, a spike in energy prices, upwards in pressure on inflation around the world. All of these are exacerbated by Russia's illegal, unprovoked war against Ukraine. We have been in regular, close contact with India regarding what we can do to hold Russia accountable and to impose additional costs on Russia for its war. We may not always share precisely the same policy approaches, but we both share a commitment to upholding a rules-based international order that respects territorial integrity and sovereignty. That is at the heart of our global strategic partnership with India. It is at the heart of what we seek to do with the Quad, with the other bilateral and multilateral work we do with our Indian partners. We agree very much with India that the restoration of an enduring peace in Ukraine is essential. This is the same message that President Zelensky himself has issued. During the G20, he spoke to the assembled world leaders, laid out his vision for a just peace. This is something that we very much welcome. We do welcome India's support for the people of Ukraine. India has provided humanitarian assistance and calls by India for an immediate end to Russia's brutal war against Ukraine. We also very much agree with Prime Minister Modi's assertion that today's era is not an era of war. Of course, that was a comment that was echoed at the G20. We've heard that comment at the UN as well. And we do believe that countries like India, countries that have a relationship with Russia and with Ukraine, may be in a position to help bring about dialogue and diplomacy that could one day put an end to this war. I say one day, and I put this in the conditional, because there is one country that, of course, has demonstrated no willingness to put an end to this war, to end the brutal aggression, and that, of course, is Russia. even in the context of recent discussions. We took note of the Kremlin statement that the Kremlin is willing to engage in dialogue, but only if the new territorial realities are recognized. That is a clear sign as any that Moscow has no genuine appetite to engage in dialogue and diplomacy that will lead to a just and durable peace. We ultimately hope to alter that calculus. We seek to alter that calculus by continuing to provide Ukraine with the security assistance it needs. Of course, we announced a significant package of security assistance today, just as we continue to hold Russia and senior Russian decision makers to account for this brutal war. It is ultimately our hope that as Moscow's calculus changes, as it comes to recognize that this war has been and will be a strategic failure, that Moscow will become more interested in genuine dialogue and genuine diplomacy that leads to a just and durable peace. And we're confident that countries like India at that moment may have a particular role to play, and we welcome that. Let's go to Rustem Kuzabayev.
Thank you. My question, exists the opinion that after withdrawal of Western troops from Afghanistan, Central Asia region is losing their importance in the foreign policy of the United States. And I want to ask, what will be the key directions of the United States foreign policy in the Central Asia in this year? Thank you.
Thank you very much. To your question, we remain deeply invested in Central Asia. We remain deeply engaged with our Central Asian partners. In fact, we strive to be a steadfast partner to the countries in the Central Asian region. We continue to support the independence, the sovereignty, the territorial integrity of the countries of Central Asia. This applies around the world, but of course equally in Central Asia. Every country around the world should be able to determine for itself freely its future, consistent with the principles of state sovereignty, of territorial integrity, of political independence. And as a reliable full-spectrum partner of the countries to the countries of Central Asia, we continue to prioritize providing resources to those countries. Recent examples of that include the $25 million to support a 21st century workforce, to expand new trade routes, and to enhance the private sector within the region that we announced fairly recently. We launched the C5+1 diplomatic platform over 7 years ago now, because Central Asia is at its strongest when governments collectively address both regional and global challenges, and that platform has been core to that. Now more than ever, we are pursuing C5+1 collaboration that leads to more impactful and sustainable solutions for the region and beyond. Cooperation with and among the governments and the peoples of Central Asia is a cornerstone, we believe, to advancing a prosperous, a stable, a democratic, and secure Central Asia. And that's really at the heart of our approach to the region. We collaborate and cooperate with these partners on many regional and bilateral programs, including through the C5+1, but not only limited to the C5+1. There are a broad array of issues, business and economic ties, professional exchanges, education and English language, health, nonproliferation, and security, building the capacity of independent civil society, independent organizations and media, enhancing regional trade, energy security, among the many areas of other areas of collaboration with these partners, and that will certainly continue.
Ned, will you take questions from outside?
Yes. Well, and then I'll go to Igor Naimushin of Rina Vosti.
Yeah. Hello, Mr. Price. Thank you for participating. So my question is regarding new U.S. ambassador in Moscow. So what shall we expect when Lynn Tracy will start her duty in Moscow? Regarding U.S.-Russian relations, what are the plans for the embassy? Are there any plans to restart visa relations? And speaking more broadly, what can you say about current irritants in U.S.-Russian relations? Could you highlight the list of them and share it with us, please? Thank you.
I'll start by saying that's a very long list, but let me begin with Ambassador Tracy. Of course, as you know, Ambassador Tracy was just confirmed late last year by the U.S. Senate to take on her role as the U.S. Ambassador in Russia. She is one of our most experienced and respected career diplomats. She has over 25 years of public service, including most recently serving as our ambassador in Armenia. But she's also one of our foremost experts when it comes to the Russian Federation and the region. Part of that owes to her previous service as deputy chief of mission in Moscow. That gives her unique and relevant experience for navigating what is, fair to say, one of the most difficult periods in our bilateral relations. Her focus will be to provide leadership to the embassy to maintain this bilateral relationship in a period of extraordinarily heightened tensions, and to work with the Russian government to improve staffing at the U.S. Embassy platform so that our embassy can perform basic functions like potentially even visa issuance. When it comes to visa services, our inability to provide visa services in Russia is due to actions by the Russian government. In April of 2021, the Russian government made it illegal for our embassy in Moscow to employ both Russian nationals and third country nationals. That determination alone meant that we had to separate over 180 employees. Many of those employees were previously in our consular section where that visa processing takes place. These cuts greatly affected our operations across the board. They impeded our ability to provide visa services. They constrained our ability to engage with the Russian government and the Russian people. We believe it's in the interests of both of our countries, in the United States and in Russia, to have fully effective functioning missions in our respective countries, including the ability to provide visa services. Our inability to do that, again, is a function of the onerous and unfair restrictions that the Russian Federation has placed on us. In terms of the irritants in the relationship, we've already talked about a couple. I will just add one more, and of course, it is the one that is known to all of you. It is Russia's brutal war against Ukraine. The fact is that we made no bones about the fact that the United States would take certain steps if Russia went forward with its plan to wage an unprovoked, illegal, unjustified war against Ukraine. We said we would do three things. We said we would support the Ukrainian government with massive amounts of security assistance, nearly $25 billion since the start of this administration. We said we would hold the Russian government to account. We've done that as well with sanctions, with export controls, with other financial and economic measures. Doing both of these things with the support and coordination of dozens of countries around the world, while also, thirdly, shoring up the NATO alliance and making sure that our defensive alliance is prepared to take on any potential aggression from the Russian Federation and the broader region. And we've had a concerted focus on the so-called eastern flank of the alliance, but as a result of these efforts, NATO has never been more united, more purposeful, more prepared to take on any potential threat from Russia. Okay, Alex?
Thank you so much, Ned. Welcome to the Foreign Press Center. Great to see you. I have a general question on US foreign policy, but before that, just starting from the news of the day, you mentioned more than $3 billion, $3.75 to the Ukraine and its partners. Or U.S. partners in the region. I know that DOD has its own saying, so they broke down a billion portion of it. My question is about $682 million that the DOS will oversee. Do you have the list of those countries? Most precisely, I'm most interested in Georgia, you know, Moldova, Azerbaijan, Armenia, because you know, the definition in this list is you define them as those impacted by Russia's war. I have another question after that.
Sure. Do you want to ask your second question?
Thanks so much.
Go ahead.
I was wondering how much Ukrainian war impacted U.S. foreign policy agenda in terms of shaping your approach to frozen conflict. You have been describing it for day in, day out in another building. But my question is, you know, now that we know why Russia is freezing those conflicts for reason, and it became abundantly clear that, you know, Russia wants to keep its influence in, you know, Georgia, Azerbaijan, Moldova, and others. I was wondering, moving forward, if you will be, the State Department is considering to take another look at those countries. Thank you so much.
Great. Thanks. So first, Alex, on your first question, yes, we did announce a massive security assistance package today, $3.75 billion in new military assistance to Ukraine. That includes $2.85 billion in additional arms and equipment to Ukraine under our drawdown authority, the so-called presidential drawdown authority. This is the 29th time that we have issued presidential drawdown. But there also is foreign military financing packages involved in this. This is funding that is not for the immediate needs of Ukraine or its neighbors, but for the longer-term resilience and longer-term defensive capabilities of these countries. Some of this FMF financing did go to Ukraine. $225 million in FMF financing did go to Ukraine today for its longer-term security needs. But as you referenced, there was an additional dispatch of $682 million in foreign military financing for regional partners and allies on NATO's eastern flank to incentivize and to help them backfill the important donations that they've made to the security assistance needs of the Ukrainian government and the Ukrainian people. If we have a full breakdown of that $682 million and the extent at which it went to particular countries, we'll provide that to you. But again, these were to our allies and partners, including to NATO allies on the eastern flank. To your question on frozen conflicts, we are, of course, cognizant of the fact that frozen conflicts, in some cases, Moscow has sought to use frozen conflicts and to freeze conflicts in place and to use that to its own strategic advantage. We've seen this in the course of several previous conflicts, several current frozen conflicts. It is why we have been so skeptical and about Russia's claims for so-called ceasefires. You heard me say yesterday that we viewed President Putin's call for a Christmas ceasefire as nothing but cynical. I think that assessment has been borne out given what we've seen over the course of the day today. We believe that our cynicism, we believe that our skepticism is warranted because of what we've seen from Russia over the course of this conflict. Previously, in the earliest days of the conflict, when Russia would call for so-called humanitarian ceasefires in places like Mariupol, we would see those immediately violated. We also know that there may be an ulterior motive in calling for a ceasefire like the one that we've heard from President Putin in recent days. It is our concern that Moscow would seek to use any potential pause in fighting to refit, to regroup, and ultimately to reattack with more vengeance, with more brutality, with even more lethality. It is not our goal to see Moscow be able to regroup and to reposition its forces just to reengage in an even more brutal fashion against the people of Ukraine. That's why we want to see a peace that is just, yes, but is also durable, a peace that is lasting, is not a conflict that is just frozen into place, but recognizes Ukraine's independence, its territorial integrity, its sovereignty, and that leaves Ukraine in a position to defend itself against future acts of aggression. Yes, in front. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, you did. Yeah, go ahead.
But sorry,
we have a lot of people in the room. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Ned. My question is on Africa, of course. We have been seeing a new wave of contaminations of COVID-19 spreading. And this, of course, worries many nations, including African nations, that are trying until today vaccinating their people. So the U.S. have been a front line when it comes to donating vaccines to many countries. But the case of Equatorial Guinea is quietly unacceptable. because this country is not asking for donation from the United States. They actually paid millions of dollars for vaccines. But until today, those vaccines have not yet been sent to Equatorial Guinea. So last time I asked the National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan about those vaccines, and he mentioned that there would be a meeting between the U.S. government and a delegation from Equatorial Guinea. But until today, we have not heard from the U.S. government about those vaccines. I've asked the White House, the National Security, and now the State Department. Can you please give us an update? What is really going on with those vaccines? Because the people in Equatorial Guinea are waiting for those vaccines. And with this new spread of contamination, they more than ever need those vaccines that are already paid from the government of Equatorial Guinea. Any update on that, please?
Understand. I'm not in a position to offer an update on those specific vaccines. I'll see if there's anything that we can provide you today on that specific case. But the broader point remains that the United States has been and stands ready to continue to be the world's leading provider of vaccines to countries and to people around the world without any political strings attached. We've already donated hundreds of millions of vaccines bilaterally, but also through the COVAX instrument. With that, we have been able to vaccinate a large share of the world's population, and we stand ready to continue to offer vaccines to countries around the world. But if there's anything we can offer on this particular vaccine batch, we'll get back to you. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Munzer Sleiman, Al-Mayadeen Network, based in Beirut, Lebanon. My question about U.S. policy toward Lebanon. As you know, the Lebanese has not yet agreed on electing president, and some people are comparing what's happening now with the House here in the United States. But in any case, what is the American policy toward electing a new president, and there is any efforts in that toward that goal, and what kind of effort is being waged? The other part of the question is, the United States, through the embassy in Lebanon, promised a long time ago to assist Lebanon to who facing a very painful economic situation, that they will facilitate the gas and electricity from Egypt and Jordan through Syria to Lebanon. That will require exemption from sanction. And the United States has offered exemption to many states that facing some economic difficulties. Why United States is not granting that exemption to Lebanon? Thank you.
Sure. So on your first question on government formation, we've repeatedly stressed this, but it is up to the Lebanese parliament to determine the next president in accordance with the demands of the Lebanese people. And these are people who, as you know, continue to face a number of significant challenges and crises. We call on Lebanon's leaders to quickly select a president and to subsequently form a government. The Lebanese people deserve political leadership willing to put the interests of the country first, and a government able and willing to implement long overdue reforms critical to unlocking that crucial international support. And that international support, I think, gets to the second part of your question. They're interrelated because Lebanon needs a government that's responsive to its people, but it also needs a government that is in a position to put the interests of the country first, to take decisions, including potentially tough decisions, that would allow the international community, international financial institutions, and others to continue to be in a position to support the Lebanese people as they have for so long now. When it comes to energy needs, the energy crisis needs a long-term solution. And the proposed regional gas deals with Egypt, with Jordan as well, we view these as an important step. The announcement on the gas deal last year was an agreement between the parties. Now it's implementation of that agreement, and it's contingent on World Bank financing that requires, as I said just a moment ago, a number of reforms that the Lebanese government must enact to unlock this very financing. After receiving this final financing information from the World Bank, in addition to contracts from the parties, the Department of State, the Department of the Treasury will review the details to assess and address any possible sanctions concerns. But first, there are certain steps that need to take place, including government formation. Yes, go ahead.
Thanks so much. I'm Sho Watanabe from Japanese Nippon TV. Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Presenter. My question is another one for Japanese strategic document. Some Japanese congressmen even suggested that we need to also revise the guidelines for Japan-U.S. defense cooperation to reflect the new strategy of Japan. So as a State Department, what's your perception on the guideline and whether or not the current guidelines should be modernized?
Oh, we do not have a position on that. That is a question for the Japanese government, so I would leave it with that. Yes, let me, Pearl, go ahead.
Ned, thanks. I've got a question on American foreign policy conduct that you've come to talk to us today about, and then also news of the day. So on FP conduct, I'm glad that you brought up the issue of press freedom at the top, and I appreciate all of your comments regarding that. So to try to thread the needle for example, our rural audiences all across the continent of Africa, Africa will face numerous countries that will be having elections. And at the end of the U.S.-Africa Leaders Summit, President Biden dedicated a tranche of money, which he said he's going to work with Congress on, towards elections. So you've got Benin has got an election this Sunday. You've got Sierra Leone, Zimbabwe, a number of different countries, including Nigeria. So thread the needle for me a little bit here. How are your resources coming along from your office and your department in general, in terms of, as the White House is formulating how the Democracy Summit is going to look, or to what extent do you have an appetite to field what foreign correspondents like ourselves are going through in terms of press freedom? And when President Biden was talking about the elections, it was somewhat vague, like, where is the money directed towards in order to strengthen these pillars towards democracy? Could you just try to thread that needle? There's a lot of little bit vague information as to what's going to happen here, given the fact that Ambassador Carson's office may or may not already be set up. Maybe give us some update as to that, because we can see as of right now that in the House there is no speaker yet elected. And I know that President Biden was talking about, some of those monies that were promised. He's going to be working with Congress on that. So try to thread the needle as to, okay, the Africa Leaders Summit is over. We're headed towards the Democracy Summit in March. Where are we at in that, and to what extent do you have an appetite to include foreign press in fielding questions as you're planning, not after you finish planning, but as you're planning, so that you can understand what we go through? On the news of the day, my question is, to the extent that you can, because I know you can't share intelligence information, but to the extent that you can, what are you hearing about what Hemeti was talking about, having thwarted a coup attempt at the border with the Central African Republic, and private military companies in Eastern DRC, and any defense articles that your State Department is working on getting for South Africa in order to strengthen the security aspect? Because all the things that were agreed at the summit, none of those will have long-term success if the security question is not attended to. And right now, South Africa has got intense challenges in terms of defense articles in order to maintain, for example, insurgencies in northern Mozambique. Eastern DRC is bubbling right now. And so whatever you can share, just to give us an update as to how do you intend to be successful in operationalizing what your foreign policy conduct is hoping to achieve. Thanks.
Thanks very much. So Pearl, to the first part of your question, first of all, let me take a step back. And the point of the Africa Leaders Summit was to invite our African partners to the United States to make clear our approach to the continent, to first make clear that we're all in on Africa. We realize that the future is in large part going to be written by African countries, by the African people, especially given the growth dynamics, the population dynamics, the demographic dynamics that we see and will see on the continent for the coming years. And I think you saw a focus on everything that the United States can bring to the table when it comes to that partnership with these with the continent. It's not only government-to-government relationships, but it's the private sector, it's NGOs, it's independent organizations, it's people-to-people ties, it's media as well. As part of that, you're referring to the $55 billion that the president announced that we seek to invest in Africa over the next 3 years across a wide variety of issue areas. That includes democracy. It includes governance. It includes education, peace and security, food, public health, trade, investment, economic growth, and humanitarian assistance. This is a sliver of what the United States is prepared to do because, again, this is not just just a question of what the United States government can do, but what America as a country can do. And over the course of the Africa Leader Summit, you heard President Biden during those few days alone announced $15 billion in private sector commercial deals. That was in addition to the, I think, $18 billion in private sector commercial deals that had been announced between the United States and Africa since 2021. So there's a lot that we bring to the table insofar as how this $55 billion will be spent. This is something that we are still we're working on with Congress. We're going to work on within the department and ultimately determine how we can put it to use most effectively. But part of that $55 billion will go towards democracy and governance programs. And this is not an interest of ours in just one country or just a handful of countries. It's an interest of ours across the continent to build, to bolster democratic resilience across the continent. Seeing, to the second part of your question, some of the instability, some of the democratic backsliding that the world has witnessed across the African continent in recent years. So we'll have more to say on this, but beyond the $55 billion that the president mentioned, you'll note that he did take part in a private meeting with many of the countries who are having elections over the course of the coming year. With the DRC, Gabon, Liberia, Nigeria, Madagascar, Sierra Leone, at the White House. These are all countries with unique challenges. These are all countries that have elections in 2023. And we wanted to make very clear that the United States, across these countries, but more broadly across the continent, we support good governance. We support democracy as a system that can deliver for the people of Africa, and that can forge the kind of partnership that we seek that ultimately delivers for our people and the people of Africa as well. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, thank you for taking my question. Hey, Junsa from Radio Free Asia. I'd like to turn to North Korea. So going forward, can we expect to see a candidate for the State Department's Special Envoy for Human Rights in North Korea? Why is the nominating process being delayed so much?
Thanks very much. So I don't have any personnel announcements. I don't have any plans to announce at this time. But I can tell you that when we look at our approach to the DPRK, we are taking into account the full array of challenges that we see from that regime and within that regime. Of course, we speak most frequently about the threat that is posed by the DPRK's ballistic missile and its nuclear weapons program, but there are other forms of malign activity and malign influence that we see emanating from the DPRK, whether it's money laundering, whether it's its malicious cyber program. But also what is happening within the regime and the systematic human rights abuses that have been perpetrated against the people of the DPRK, that's something that is of deep concern to the United States. It's of deep concern to our allies in the Indo-Pacific and to our partners around the world. So special envoy or not, this is a focus of ours. We, even in the midst of a robust sanctions regime that owes to North Korea's ballistic missile, its ballistic missiles, its nuclear weapons program, we seek to do all that we can to support the people of the DPRK. Of course, all of our sanctions programs have humanitarian carve-outs. That is true of the DPRK as well. We know that they are under immense suffering because of famine, because of malnutrition, but also because of the repression that their own government is inflicting upon them. And it's our goal, in the first instance, not to add to that and to do everything we can, consistent, of course, with the state of our relations and with the decisions that the DPRK itself has made, to do everything to advance their humanitarian interests as well. Yes. Sure, go ahead.
Thank you, Ned, for doing this on Bangladesh and what is U.S. policy on Bangladesh, as you are asking for, you are urging for free, fair, and credible election and call for Bangladesh for respect the fundamental rights for a long time. But the country's scenario is different. They are rather, they are not listening. The few days ago, the foreign minister and deputy state minister, they organized an open meeting. They invited all ambassadors, including U.S. ambassador, and they're giving lecture the how U.S. the election process is question. They are questioning about U.S. election, and they are telling that the human rights abuse is higher than Bangladesh and here, but they are not listening U.S. And we experienced two physical elections, 2014 and 2018, and we saw the strong position on U.S., but still the regime is in power more than a decade. So what would be the U.S. role if the country is going like this and they, you know, they are not willing to go for any neutral election under a caretaker government? And second question, would you please confirm, is Assistant Secretary Donald Rowe visiting Bangladesh, as Bangladesh Foreign Ministry circulated news to the media that he's visiting for the bilateral meeting? Thank you.
Thanks very much for your question. So on the elections, Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina has said that she and her government want free and fair parliamentary elections. We welcome those words, but most importantly, we are going to be watching to make sure that those words are ultimately matched with corresponding actions. We look forward to better understanding how the government will work to ensure that these elections are carried out the way they should be. That is, in a manner that is genuine, transparent, and peaceful. The next parliamentary elections are still some time away, but we support constructive actions Bangladesh can take ahead of the polls to carry out a genuine electoral process. We're, of course, concerned every time, anywhere, we hear of violence, of harassment, of intimidation, of politicians, of independent voices, of opposition party members. That, of course, is the case in Bangladesh. When we see it, and when we have seen it in Bangladesh, we've had private conversations with the government to register our concerns. Our ambassador in Bangladesh is doing an extraordinary job, not only representing the United States, but also standing up for the values that are really at the core of our approach to foreign policy, to human rights, to democracy, to a vision that is free and open. And that's something that he will continue to do. Yes, in the back, in the last room.
Thank you. This is Yijin from Pyongyang Daily News. And White House announced that when the U.S. and Japan leaders meet next week, they will be discussing, one of the agendas will be strengthening trilateral security cooperation between Japan, U.S. and RK. Could you elaborate on what specific areas of discussion will be? And would it be going beyond information sharing and joint exercises? And also, would the U.S. support the idea of trilateral defense and foreign ministers meetings, 2+2 format of three countries?
Thanks very much. So of course, we have an ironclad relationship with our Japanese allies that will be on full display next week when we have a 2+2 format with our Japanese allies and when the President and Prime Minister convene at the White House on Friday. The bilateral relationship we have with Japan is indispensable to our shared vision of a free and open Indo-Pacific. But there are certain challenges, and the DPRK is at the top of that list, where it's especially important for us to have an effective trilateral relationship as well. This administration, since our earliest days, has sought to revitalize the trilateral format, bringing together our ROK and Japanese allies, knowing that the challenges we confront in the Indo-Pacific, as well as the opportunities, but certainly the challenges, would benefit from a seamless and unified trilateral approach. Secretary Blinken has had a number of opportunities now to convene with his ROK and Japanese allies in the trilateral format. President Biden was able to bring together his trilateral counterparts in the Indo-Pacific region just a couple months ago as well. This will be a topic of conversation with our Japanese allies. It's a topic of conversation with our ROK allies, just as the threat that the region, Japan, the ROK, other allies and partners face from the DPRK in the context of next week's discussions. I think I have time for one final question. Yes, right here. Go ahead.
I want to go back to China. Is there any concerns about the current Chinese COVID outbreak that might delay or jeopardize Secretary's trip to Beijing? And also, if so, is there any like plan B for it? And for the trip, what are the goals that the U.S. want to, you know, achieve, or anything expectations in mind, like for the future U.S.-China relations?
So we are moving forward with the planning for the Secretary to visit Beijing in the coming weeks. We, of course, are paying attention to the course of the COVID-19 outbreak in the PRC, but we still are planning for the Secretary to travel to the PRC early this year, as was announced late last year. When it comes to the outbreak, I'd make a couple points. Of course, first and foremost, we want to see this outbreak come to an end. We want to see the PRC put an end to this stage of the epidemic. And I say that for a few reasons. Of course, we don't want to see illness, suffering, death anywhere around the world. Secondly, this has, with an economy as large as the PRC's, has the potential to have economic implications for countries well beyond the PRC. And third and finally, anytime the virus is spreading anywhere, it has the potential to mutate, to create variants, to spread beyond national borders, and to be a public health threat to people everywhere. And that, of course, is especially true when it is circulating in such a large population in a way that may not be fully controlled. So we've made very clear, as I did to your colleague, that we are the world's leading provider of vaccines to people and countries around the world. Hundreds of millions of doses have made their way into arms of people around the world. We have offered COVID vaccines to the PRC. They've said publicly that they appreciate the offer, but they're not in need of it right now. We'll continue to discuss this with them, of course. When it comes to the Secretary's travel, as I said, I think in the response to the first question, our engagement with the PRC is principally about one thing, and that is managing what is arguably the most consequential bilateral relationship in the world responsibly. And so the Secretary is going to be in a position to discuss the full range of issues that are on the table in that relationship, those areas of competition. I would expect that much of the discussion, if not most of the discussion, will be focused on these areas of competition. There will also be a discussion of the areas where we need to ensure that we have the ability to maintain dialogue, to see to it that that competition doesn't veer into conflict. But then there are areas where the rest of the world expects the United States and China to work together. I've mentioned a couple of them already, including climate, including global health and others. Those are also areas that will be on the table. So this will be an opportunity, again, to exercise that ability to sit down, to discuss the full range of issues, to see to it, and to demonstrate to the world in a way that the United States and the PRC are prepared and willing and ready to manage this relationship responsibly. Thank you all very much. I appreciate it.
Can I follow up on Secretary's statement, please?
Go ahead. Take a final question. Sorry.
Marcin Wrona, TV and Warner Bros. Discovery from Poland. So obviously, it's a question about the eastern flank. $682 million. When do you think this will be accessible, when this help will be accessible? Is this aimed only to replace the equipment donated to Ukraine? Or are you also planning to boost the defenses in any other way? Will you be training the troops in countries like Poland? And are you also hoping to, you know, boost the intelligence sharing with this money, with what's in the Secretary's statement?
So I'm cognizant that my colleagues at the DOD probably just concluded a briefing where they went into some of this in depth. I would just say that this money is similar to money that the Secretary has announced for our European allies last year, in the sense that it is not for immediate defensive security needs. This is to enhance long-term defensive resilience. In this case, it's to countries that are impacted by Russia's brutal war against Ukraine, including those countries like Poland, that have been in a position to be generous with their own weapons and their own supplies. We want to make sure that the NATO alliance, that our European allies and partners are prepared to respond to any acts of aggression, whether that comes from Russia or anywhere, any other country. And the fact that many countries have been in a position to be generous with their own capabilities and capacities to the government of Ukraine means that we want to be in a position to step in, to see to it that they can continue that generosity, and in doing so, that they can continue to maintain that degree of preparedness and readiness for any potential threats. Thank you very much.